way to start the second part off with my worst song on the album, Erosion. Now that's not to say it's a bad song, the song is still very, very good and I still enjoy it. I would not skip it, I'd never skip it, even though it is my worst. It's just, there's not as much kind of going on and just a lot of other kind of issues that kind of hold it back from the kind of epicness that is surrounding this song. It's just, this one really kind of falls flat from being that next level which this band brings constantly through the album. So, this song is 7 minutes 4 seconds, so it is a pretty lengthy track. So there's probably going to be a few kind of unique things in here, and technically there actually isn't. There's not as much going on here than you could say Escape. Now Escape, again, wasn't an overly long song. The first track, The Room, was not overly long, but was still had a lot of elements. Erosion doesn't actually have that many, which is weird seeing that this is the song that's kind of stretching it to 7 plus minutes, barely. So starting the song off, you have some softness. It's going for something a little bit soft, and the original male vocalist, the actual male vocalist of the band, I'll say, is just singing in this quite kind of high voice. It's not exactly a whisper, but it's got this quite high pitch to it, and it's just goes for a while. So yeah, it's just soft. The voice has got this quite soft yet high pitch to it, and yeah, people may expect, oh, is this going to be it? It isn't, so it kind of builds anticipation. Where is this song going to go? This obviously isn't going to be the chunk and signature and staple of the song. So it's going to go somewhere. Where will it go? So it builds anticipation, which is a great thing to have, instead of the bands that just start the song off immediately with this is the song, don't expect anything to change, this is what you get, start to finish. So I do kind of appreciate that there is a build and it does kind of go somewhere new, which you're not expecting, so it's just trying to figure out where is this going to take you. So it actually gets heavier, and this is one of the more kind of like heavy tracks, heavy for Ostura at least. They don't get proper, you know, heavy death metal vibe stuff, which would kill this album. It would be ridiculous if they did that. But it does go heavier. You've got a really good mid-tempo kind of beat to it. It's got this kind of beefy sound to it, so the riff is really fat and everything. It still has some warmth to it. It's not, you know, tinny and kind of dead of warmth at all. The voice is still the main guy of the band singing along. The higher notes that you do get when stuff gets heavier is the third singer, which isn't in the actual band. So the higher voice is usually him. Even though the original, the actual male of the band can achieve high notes, the higher the male voice, the more likely it is that it is this kind of third singer who's a guest. So, yeah, there is the higher male voice through the song, and then you have the more kind of deeper voice. I kind of prefer the kind of deeper voice. I just think there's just a kind of a lot more character to his voice. The other one just kind of seems to be using just power and highs just to kind of show it off, instead of really kind of going for some kind of character and understanding of kind of the song. So I prefer him myself. You do get the kind of symphonic nature and elements of the song, so the chorus, it opens it up, and then the orchestra comes in. It's one of their more epic, big-sounding songs. The second verse, it's still pretty much exactly the same as the first, so it doesn't really change. There's a small kind of break with the band where it kind of opens up and lets the orchestra kind of come through in the middle of the verse, just to add a bit more kind of melody and differentiate a little, I guess. But then it just kind of comes back into the standard verse. And you get a chorus, you get your bridge. The bridge section, you've got orchestrations, you have male choir singers in there. You do have a solo. This solo is the weakest on the album as well. Like, the amount of guests they have and the phenomenal guitarists they have, this solo is kind of like one of them things where it's like, it's good, but they've got like the best guitarist worldwide. This really falls flat. Why did they go for this option? It's got length. It's not short and pathetic. It has length. So it is a decent length. Starting off, it's just a lot of held notes. It's just, okay, he's holding notes. It's not exactly musical or got a good melody or tone to it. It's holding notes, and then he does some technical things, but it's not like amazing technical prowess. And as I said, there's nothing really musical about it, so it's just kind of like a solo that's just dumped in. It's like, yeah, all the solos I get really interesting techniques and technicality stuff. This solo falls flat matching up to them things. It also really falls flat of melody. The solo pretty much completely lacks it, which every solo needs to maintain no matter what it's doing, even if it's really brutal. It has to have some sort of melody and musicality to it, unless it's just kind of the void husk of a solo, which is really a big problem. But that is basically the song. It starts off with that kind of softer side. You don't know where the song's going to take you. And then it does get a bit kind of heavier, and then it's just this really kind of cool sounding stuff. The choruses, that kind of big epic thing. The song finishes on that whisper kind of thing again that plays into the next track. The solo is pretty pathetic. There are, the symphony is there. You do get a male choir. So it is still very good compared to the usual music that is out today, but as far as Ostura, it is kind of lacking. Okay then, The Only One. Now this is a really good track again. 6 minutes 53 seconds, near enough 7 minutes. And the interesting thing about this song, which is going to be fascinating for a few of you, is I have no bloody clue if this song even has a chorus. The song just keeps going. It never seems to repeat a phrase or have a chorus. I know when they say The Only One, which is the title of the song, I'm guessing that's what the chorus is, but nothing kind of sounds the same as whenever they do it. So I think the song just goes. There's not really a solid verse that they repeat. There's not even a chorus. So it's just a constantly changing song, which I think is one of the big things that works wonders in it, as well as the fact that the solo in this is like now one of the greatest solos I've ever heard. This song is killer. Now it comes off of Erosion. As Erosion quietens down and fades, Only One just begins and comes out of the fadiness of the previous track with this beautiful piano. And this is amazing. Again, I just love the sound of the piano. It's got this real nice beauty to it. The male is singing. You don't get the second male. It is the original singer who is singing in this track. And he's singing along with the kind of piano and everything. And everything's just got this kind of beauty to it. This fantastic melody. He sounds fantastic. There is a menace about it though. Even though it is the piano and this nice voice, it's just the kind of way the piano plays. It plays it like it's got this nice element to it, but you shouldn't 100% trust it. It's got this real kind of menace about it. Even with the vocalist, he's got this kind of darkness in him that just kind of seems to kind of go unnoticed. So I do kind of like the tone that has this mix of beauty with this kind of really subtle dark undertow. I think that's quite well achieved. As the song kind of starts kicking into higher gear, they actually kind of use the digital effects, which I mentioned in part one that they do actually use. So there's some kind of digital computer effect-y thingy-crappy things going on that kind of just takes it to just an increment up. And this is when the female comes back, which is a welcome change. She was definitely missed in Erosion. I think another problem with Erosion was the fact that the female is so incredible and she's such a phenomenal singer that whenever you take her out, you just thirst to hear her again. So, yeah, she comes in and is sounding nice. You've got some kind of strings and certain things. It interchanges between man and her. And then they kind of build it up. So when the song starts building up, they kind of come together, a duet, and then that riff kicks in and it's got this kind of heaviness to it. Oh crap, I'm dropping bottles. And yeah, it's not a technical kind of riff or anything. It's just got this great kind of beat to it. It's got a great tone to it. And then the voice, the way it kind of flows with the music, sounds absolutely perfect. You got some kind of horn instruments, I think. I don't believe they're strings. I think that's what they are, just horns. But this entire kind of verse aspect keeps kind of changing tempo. So you've got a kind of certain riff, and then it's got more of a beat to it, and then there's more kind of a speed and urgency about it, and then the vocalist will kind of keep changing. It's all man, this portion. The female has completely disappeared. This then takes us into the solo, which just erupts in just insanity. It's a really, really technical solo. It's got a lot of skill. There's a fuck ton of speed in there. It's very difficult. He's using the entire length of the neck. He does have elements where he will slow it down just a little bit and just do a few kind of holds and just hold on a certain note just to break it up a little bit. So there's a lot going on and shows great showmanship and technicality, which is brilliant. But then the best part is the second aspect, which is when the solo seems to come out and then he changes from one guitar to a different guitar to get a whole different sound from it, as well as a whole different genre of play. It's full out blues. I am not kidding, it's not, oh, it's blues like Sinister Gate style things. No, it's literal blues. He is 100% playing a blues solo. It is fantastic to hear. It's got such grace and such beauty about it. It sounds absolutely phenomenal. The change of the guitar just makes the kind of tone work. He really wants to emphasize on this solo and make it really stand out. And it really does. Like, it works absolutely perfect. The solo is absolutely phenomenal. So, I love it. Coming off of the solo, we get the female back. Everything goes kind of softer again. And, yeah, you've got piano back again, you've got her voice, and then the male will come back. When he comes back, he's definitely got this real nice kind of grace and flow with how he's singing his notes, along with kind of the orchestra playing with him. And then he goes into the high note to bring it back into the heaviness and everything. So getting it back up into the kind of heavier range. You got some female choir singers. It's very kind of operatic and everything, and then it goes into more ferocity from his voice. There's a riff which just kind of falls over itself, then it starts kind of getting into this great set piece of a riff, and it sounds amazing. And then it ends on orchestra, choir again, which then gets us into the next track, Morning Light. Right, so this track is only 3 minutes 8 seconds, which a lot of you are going to complain about off the bat from just hearing that immediately. You won't want it any longer, trust me. This is a song basically all for the female who's playing the girl. This song is all just for her and just to just show how incredible her voice is. There's not much to it. It is mostly just her singing. There's a piano. There's some strings and things. And that is basically the song. That is all it is. So a few of you may complain, well, this what I'm on is a metal channel. You're kind of like metal. This is supposed to be also this album kind of metal and stuff. So why do we kind of want piano and things? Well, it's just like, it's like this. What comes after this track and everything that's happened before, it's one track, that is it. So is it a track which is like, oh, there's not much to it, I kind of want all the heaviness and the solos and crap like that? It's just like, no. It's a journey. If you listen to the album in its entirety, it's just songs kind of blend into each other, and it's just like an extension, and it goes places. And there's so much variation in this album and beauty that it's an experience, and that is what this song is. I do enjoy listening to this even as a standalone, because the thing is unbelievably fucking beautiful. It is insanely gorgeous, this song. But yeah, I understand people like who want the heavier stuff, don't really like soft things. But the piano is so graceful and so beautiful. Her voice does kind of keep elevating, and it goes places. She's not just singing in one tone. She is really using a range of these really beautiful notes and absolute beauty. There's softness, there's grace, there's elegance to her voice. There's some high notes, there's some absolute beautiful things she does. The strings, again, they're very subtle, but it does add. They're just this angelic voice mixed with this unbelievably beautiful sounding piano. It is so beautiful and so perfect that if you admire music and talent, this is a phenomenal song for a voice. The piano is phenomenal. It is an instrument. So if you care about music, then you should like this. And as I say, it is an experience and is the one only. And coming off of a melody, where would you want it to go? Just to get more of the same? Well, that's the thing, where this song ends and where it goes to after. So coming off of the most melodic, simple kind of tracks, the best thing to do after that is to follow directly and immediately into Deathless, the heaviest track on the album, which is 6 minutes 30 seconds. Great way to do it. It has great flow from going from the softest, most beautiful thing into the most aggressive and heaviest song on the album. Really well done. Starting the song off, you actually don't have the kind of band. It just kind of starts off with that kind of movie score that you kind of get in, I don't know, War of the Worlds, The Dark Knight, that real big doomsday noise, which is the wah type of fucking bloody thing with a lot of bass behind it. So that's kind of how it starts. It's definitely kind of got this kind of doomy kind of sound going for it. And then there is a lot of strings in this song, heavy emphasis on strings throughout this. The band come in, you know, kind of the heavy riffs, you've got the strings, they're not being elegant, they are being very sharp and precise in their play to give it that kind of sharp, aggressive touch with string playing. Getting into your verse, it's the male vocalist who is a part of the band. As he kind of begins, everything kind of cuts out and kind of fades. It's still kind of in the background as he sings a portion, then it comes back. And then you've got all the kind of strings and the orchestra there going with him, all sounding quite kind of menacing. The other male vocalist there comes back doing the higher stuff. Female's not in the song at all. She's had her part, so this is, again, the guy's stuff. Also, it is a concept album, so it kind of only makes sense for her to be where she's needed, because she's a character called the girl. So it'd be weird if the girl became somebody else all of a sudden. The pre-chorus actually kind of goes quite soft. There you get the actual vocalist in that section. So he takes the first part of the verse, the higher singer takes the second part of the verse. Then we get the kind of softer element before the chorus hits, with the original. and then he also takes the chorus. The chorus again is going for that kind of movie kind of score, big anthemic sound. It's a bigger sound, it sounds epic, it sounds phenomenal. The chorus, it just is really this great sound. And the typical singer of the band, the main one, goes a little higher here than he did in the verse, which was doing that bit more of a heavy nature in his singing. The best part about this chorus, though, is how it ends. That's my favourite part. Because right at the end, out of nowhere, it just kind of all calms down, and then it's just piano. And then his voice is really lightly and really elegant and beautiful just over this piano aspect. And it's just going from how aggressive this song is, and then the big anthemic kind of chorus that they have, is going to this just real sort of beautiful piano and his beautiful voice in this section. Just for this brief time, it's just like, that was just so tasteful and so beautifully done. And it is like it lasts just a few seconds. It's like one of my favourite part of the songs. The songs, not songs. Coming out of there, we kind of come back with the high pitched singer doing the same typical kind of verse. And then we kind of do everything till we get to the bridge section. The bridge section has choir and everything. They're quite ferocious, kind of going in the kind of vibe of what the song's doing, of course. There is a lead interlude nearer the start, which I forgot to mention. It's kind of going for a bit of a melodic nature. It's a little short, so it's not a full-fledged solo. Has length to it, so it is kind of a bit longer than an interlude, but shorter than what you would expect an actual solo to be, so it's kind of in the middle there. And it is kind of going for a bit more kind of this melody instead of doing anything quite technical. But as for the actual solo, the solo is just unbelievable. It's absolutely incredible. The tone of it is perfect in this song, and then it's just really technical stuff. He really knows how to kind of play the notes and everything that he's doing, because the first portion is holds and speed and everything with this epic tone, and then the second portion he kicks it into a gear which just has this amazing kind of fun groove about it. It's a shame that he doesn't extend that section, because when he kicks it into that area, the solo just has this incredible sound and flow to it. And just, I really want to hear more of that, because that just sounded unbelievably fun. So I do kind of, I'm a little annoyed that that's not extended, because I just really want to hear more of that, because it really sounds amazing. But as far as it goes, it is a perfectly lengthened solo. It isn't short at all. And it's phenomenal. Then we go back again into kind of the high singer, back into kind of choruses, and then that little soft part near the end of the chorus, which is phenomenal. The first string pre-chorus sections with the melodic singing, and then the other strings, you get the choir back yet again near the end. So even though it's the heaviest track, they still use a lot of variation and they incorporate melody still into it, just to make it this really big epic song, instead of just not, this is just heavy and that is it. Darker Shade of Black is a pretty long track. It's 9 minutes 11 seconds. It has all three singers, and it's pretty much a melodic song. But it does have heavy and dark elements in there as well. They've got 9 minutes to play with, so the song can pretty much go anywhere. But it is beautiful, and it does have your kind of heavier elements, which is great. It has a solo, which is brilliant, so it's really good. Starting off though, there's not much happening. It takes a while for things to kind of start coming in and presenting themselves. So it's just these kind of kind of sounds and nothing really much happening. You start getting flutes, which it's something new. It sounds nice. It's musical. I always like hearing a new kind of instrument, a new take, a new kind of instrument which can convey its talent, its beauty. I like hearing talent. So it's nice. You get violins in here. You get a clean guitar. I think it's probably acoustic, actually. So everything's sounding pretty damn pleasant. And then you get one of the singers. I'm not too sure which one it is. It could be the higher one. It's kind of hard to tell because I think both of them have a similar kind of tone of this verse section. So it's not really high and it's not bass orientated either. So it is kind of like meeting in the middle of these two singers. So I'm not entirely sure which one it is. But it is basically you just kind of got this kind of clean guitar and these kind of strings going along with this really nice tone voice. And it's not melodic, like it's not slow and really kind of dark melodic. It's just this really pleasant melody and everything, which is very relaxing and very pleasing. I believe the female actually takes it higher, so when the whole kind of band kind of come in and start putting the game back into the stuff, it's the female actually doing it. So she's using a bit of kind of power in her voice. It's not as powerful as it she has been. It's not as beautiful as she has been either. It's just kind of typical singing from her at this point. She then leads the verse coming back again. So all the clean stuff and after the flute disappears from going from that kind of build up back to the soft element. You've got your flute, your strings and your things, but going back into the verse, clean stuff comes in, clean guitar, all that stuff. And she sings the melody. She's a lot more beautiful here. It's definitely the best place where you like her voice being. Coming off of that, the male vocalist comes back. I definitely know this is the actual singer of the band male voice because it's got that kind of deepened bass to it. So he's definitely got that kind of aggression in there, and then the music goes kind of heavy gain and everything. So that sounds pretty phenomenal. It's heavy and stuff. It doesn't last overly long. It does kind of immediately go back into that soft element again, which is the best interplay between the male and the female on the album, I think. So it's the male kind of leading it. So it's all the acoustic and stuff again, and he's just singing this real nice stuff. And then every now and then, the female's just in the background, just with these really soft and elegant, beautiful notes that she's singing. So as he's singing and everything's really pleasant, she comes in just adds this unbelievable, highest as hell levels of beauty to it. Along with this, just, oh, this is just quite relaxing and pleasant. And then every now and then it's just, oh my god, that was fucking beautiful. And moments. Kick into overdrive again, getting back to the kind of heavy nature. And there's kind of duets, I kind of think, with the original vocalist and the high both males. The solo in this is played by Iron, something like that. Who is a phenomenal musician. So if you just look up Iron, it is basically a solo artist, so it's himself, and he's a composer, so he brings the vocalist, he brings the drums and the bass, he brings loads of guests in to do what he writes, and then he does all the guitar work. I don't know if he can play anything else to go, but it is basically just him. And then he uses a fuck ton of special guests. So as far as this solo goes, it's got melody to it, but it's not slow and it's not really soft either. So it's got this kind of dark element to it, and there is a lot of kind of holds and melody to it. There is a tiny bit of technicality, but it's very unused, the technical side of the solo. So it is mostly just kind of holds and kind of being more of this dark kind of melody and broodiness about it. The guitar's tone kind of has a bit of this kind of whine about it, kind of just like it's in kind of pain. not like it's high and it's sharper at all. It just kind of sounds like the guitar is kind of sad. Not this bright or great kind of sound. It's just got this real eeriness about it. And then coming off of that, there's the kind of male vocalist again with the kind of bass in his voice. And then you've still got your strings and you've got your flutes and you've got your violins and all sorts in the play with the two vocalists at the end of the song. So, yeah, there's a hell of a lot going on with this song, seeing that it's melodic, heavy, broody, dark, menacing, yet beautiful and elegant, and there's a lot going on with this. It's an awesome track, like the beautiful moments, it's like, God, are these beautiful, and then the heavier moments, it's like, this is heavy, this is quite dark, and then just immediately it's like, wow, this is unbelievably beautiful and relaxing, and it's just like, this is very unnerving. And then it's like, wow, this is really beautiful. Oh my God, this is dark and got this creepy tone to it. And then, oh my God, is this fucking beautiful. It's all over the place like that. But it is executed very, very well. Because obviously kind of saying that it's there and then there and then there and then there. Probably comes across like, well, maybe it's messy. It isn't. They definitely know what they're doing, these guys. It's very well put together and things. So, an incredible song. So let's get into the next one, which is The Surge. So unfortunately this track is again another one of the worst tracks of the album. Still not something I'd skip over and still has some great elements to it, but it being 6 minutes and 8 seconds long, so that is a fairly long song, it doesn't have a solo. It also takes a while for the song to even begin. It's only the one vocalist, so you don't even have the multiple ranges of singers. You don't have the female here, you don't have two different type of male vocalists, one having a bit more of a deeper voice, one having a higher voice. At least I don't think the higher guy's here, I think it is just basically the male singer of the band. I'm pretty sure it's just him, 90%. But yeah, the fact that the song takes a while to start, like it is very slow to get going, and then when it does, it's like, oh, this from now on is really good, but then there's not even a solo. It's quite disappointing because the rest of the songs have surrounded us in all of these amazing things, so much variation, this fun, these melodies and everything, and The Surge kind of lacks all of it. It doesn't have this great melody about it. It's not really that heavy either. There's not a lot of variation. It still has variation to it because the orchestra's present again. There are backup singers. At the end of the song, they actually go dubstep, which is something, I guess. But it definitely kind of lacks because it's a song that is surrounded by so much stuff. And then you got something like that. So, starting off, there's not really a lot going on. You've got some little oriental kind of guitar stuff in your intro. And then the male vocalist comes in with his bass style voice and it's just kind of singing. There's not really much in the background musically. There's no kind of piano. There's not really anything. And it goes for a while like that. Then when it builds up, it's like, this sounds pretty great. The build up is a lot of these strings. It's like, this sounds great. This sounds something big and huge. And then the guitar riff comes in and everything, and it sounds fantastic. And then his voice with his heavy element, and it's like, this really kind of sounds brilliant. It's got this great kind of tone and style to it. The way it flows is great. It goes softer again, but it actually has a build up, and like kind of the original start of the song, it doesn't really kind of build, it just kind of starts eventually. So it kind of builds, and it kind of builds in this really nice way. It's got a nice kind of melody about it, and it sounds great. But then other than that, it's just basically near the end you get male kind of gang vocals along with him, and then you've got the dubstep end, and that is it. So there's not really a lot, there's just this really slow start. And then the build with the violins and then going into the kind of groove of the song, the main focus of it, sounds great. But coming off into the melody aspect again has this better growth about it, which really works. And the dubstep end, even though I fucking hate dubstep, I am pleased to hear it because it's very little used. So I just like it being there just for the variation. So I appreciate that. Then not even having a solo when that is all this song really has. When all the other songs, there is so much and I don't even think I cover everything. And I go into a fuck ton of detail and I talk a lot with all this detail. And I've covered this. This is it. That's it over. There's nothing else to it. So let's get into which is technically the last song, which is Duality. Okay, so Duality is 12 minutes, 9 seconds. This is a big one, and they're definitely trying to go out on something big and epic, especially at the end. The end is exhausting just how big it gets. So, starting off this track, starts with some kind of, you know, them kind of digital kind of effects stuff. The kind of flute stuff to come back in again and everything sounding quite bright and cheery until the kind of guitar comes in. It's like, okay, we're going for something a bit more kind of heavy kind of metal style of stuff with the kind of beefy kind of sounding guitars. Then the vocalist comes in, the actual vocalist of the band who does the most of the song, I think. I do think the higher guy's there who helps them in the chorus, if not takes the whole chorus. Other than that, it's always the actual singer, I believe. So when he comes in for this verse section, it just sounds amazing. He's got this great kind of tone to him and great flow. It really works with the music underneath him. The riff has some technical elements to it. It's not an easy kind of riff to do. It does have some kind of range of talent, more so than just being able to play a bloody chord. The chorus sounds quite kind of anthemic, as well as the lyrics themselves actually kind of jump out, which is there is darkness and there is light, we are part of this wonder, we're one but not the same. These lyrics really jump out to me because to me it just kind of seems that the band's trying to just say that everyone is the same, everyone has their differences, but we are all deep down exactly the same at the end of the day. And the world does have its dark elements, but it also does have its good points too. And that's the same with people, everyone has a darkness in them, but there is also light. And it's in all of us, we all share the exact same light and darkness, it just depends of how each individual takes and interprets themselves. And even though we all come from different backgrounds and believe in different things, deep down to the core, we are all exactly the same. It says a lot to me. This may be nowhere close to what the band is actually on about, so that's just what I take from it, which I think is beautiful. But I could be wrong. But I think that's what they're getting at. So that just sounds really big and anthemic. Some of these words that he says, where it's like, we're part, and it's just like, he has such this kind of vibrato on his voice, which he just puts so much emphasis and emotion into this with his performance in this chorus. And he changes the chorus. Each chorus has some different effects and different kind of vocal emotion pushes of him. So each time it's the same, but different. And I don't know if they were kind of going for that, as in what the lyrics do, which is we are all different, but down to the core we are exactly the same. And that kind of works with the chorus every time they approach it. It's always the same, but there is always something slightly different about it. So I find that, again, very interesting. Going back into the same verse, it is pretty much exactly the same. Has this great kind of sound to it, great kind of voice. The higher guy kind of comes in near the end aspect. And they do this, and then the chorus, I think they both do it the same, if not just the higher guy. There's a guitar interlude at the beginning section of the song, just to give you something there, because it is 12 minutes 9, so they do kind of space these guitar elements out, so it's just an interlude at the start. There is softer elements, so where the female actually does come in, so she's back to do her last part. It is very kind of short, which is disappointing that she doesn't have the end, but obviously it's a concept album, so it has to work within the story, so that is the problem with that. So, it is a shame that on the last song she couldn't really go out with a bang at all. But she takes this melodic part, so it's kind of, you know, like strings, piano stuff, and her. So she sounds very, very angelic in this middle portion of the track. And then again, there is strings, and there was a flute, so the male vocalist comes back. The mid-piece solo, you get technical stuff from the solo, and then immediately following him you actually get a keyboard solo. Now there is a keyboardist. The keyboardist is the one who orchestrates the orchestra, so I'm curious if he is the one actually doing the key solo. I'm not aware, but I will find out at some point. But so we've had the lead interlude near the beginning, we've had the lead solo in the middle, which is quite technical, immediately followed by a technical key solo, and then coming off of there, again we kind of have a melodic area with the male voice with acoustics and pianos and kind of things. We have gang vocals, we have choirs near the end, there's a solo near the end of the song as well, which goes for melody this time, so we definitely get our variations of solos. We have our solos all spaced out in this 12 minute epic. Right at the end of the song though, which is where it gets really epic, is we have choirs, gang vocals, we have the actual vocalist, and we got the keys, the strings, all doing the chorus all at once. So there is so much choir, orchestra, himself, gang vocal stuff, all doing this chorus at the end, which just makes it sound so fucking huge. And yeah, that is pretty much the album closing. So there is the last track, which is Exit the Room, which is basically just kind of orchestrational stuff, and it's basically it's just an album closer. There is no kind of vocals, no real band or much going on about it. It's just kind of the orchestra just kind of closing the scene, because obviously this album is kind of going for this kind of cinematic kind of stuff. So that's what it does. So it is basically the album. So talking about it now, what have we got? It's a masterpiece. It is absolutely phenomenal. This female singer is so, so bloody gifted. She is such a phenomenal singer. She has the opera stuff. She has this real angelic stuff with the piano. She has some heavier elements where she just has this great angelic voice to her, which makes her sound phenomenal. She is unbelievably perfect. The actual male of the voice of the band, again, he has a great voice, great range. The higher guy definitely adds more kind of range to the album, so it's great hearing him as well. As for the songs, we got our kind of more simplistic but not simplistic at all songs, which are so phenomenal. Then we got the really melodic stuff. We had that Morning Light, which was so beautiful and really showed the beauty of the female. Then we had Deathless, the really heavy shit, the darker shade of black, which was a mix of heavy and beauty. And then again, the last track, something huge in scope and has a really great chorus, and right at the end it just kind of really goes out there with itself and making it sound really huge and big in size and scope. There is so much variation and such beauty in this, and they've still got that aggression to them. The solos in here are so bloody amazing. Deathless has such a bloody fun solo. You really like solos which just sound so fucking fun, then Deathless will seriously work for you. Only One, the fact that is a fucking blue solo, the second portion of that coming off of the first portion, which is his balls to the wall technical. It is so unbelievable. The darker shade of black, Aaron is solo, that is fantastic. The orchestra is phenomenal, the pianos are phenomenal. Everything in this is perfect. So what are the complaints? There's erosion, I thought that lacked a little. There was a surge as well. I think in the grand scheme of what this album is, I think that is definitely easily picked as one of the weaker, because it's missing so much of that huge scale epicness that the whole rest of the album has brought out to it. But other than that, everything else is kind of perfect. I can't do anything else. Solos are perfect, voices are perfect. They offer so much. The orchestration is perfect, the piano is perfect. I do find it a little disappointing the amount that we did get from the female. She was present from, you know, start to finish, but there was definitely more emphasis on male voices than her. Again, it is a concept album, so it has to work within the story of the album. I am aware of this, but she was so perfect, I wanted more. So that is not a complaint, that is a good thing, because she was so fantastic. I want to hear her voice so much more. And even though I still have so many listens to this album before it starts getting a little bit boring, if it ever does, I am already so fucking hyped to hear where they go next, and I hope they make another album. This band, this album is phenomenal, and hearing their first album, which is a typical power metal album that sounds medieval style, and then going to this, it's quite something, because their first album is nothing like this, nowhere near the scope of this thing. So I hope they do something like this again. This is phenomenal. Rating this album, it is going to be a 9.5 out of 10. It is damn pretty much just a masterpiece. It is like a classic. It is a masterpiece. It is a must buy for everyone. Now, if you want the physical copy, as I said in part one, they did struggle immensely with getting this album out and getting a record label. So they are mostly MP3 based. Physical, the label didn't think they would be capable of really selling that much to give them profit. There are physicals out there. Amazon.co.uk, because I live in Britain, does have it. But it will cost me £35, which in dollars is going to be, $50 maybe, I don't fucking know. But it will be more than what $45 is for you, because the pound's cheaper for you. So yours is going to be higher. So, yeah, that's very expensive for an album. But if I have the money, it is unbelievably worth it, even at the 35. If there's a way to get it cheaper, like if you're in America and it is cheaper, then fucking get the bloody thing. If it is too much, then seriously, just get it on MP3. But I like having a collection, and this is something that I want to have physical and seen in my collection of albums. So yeah, this is a classic. This is a masterpiece. It's a must own. It is damn near perfect. Apart from, as I said, two faults with songs. I would have preferred to see a bit more of the female, but I understand why not, and these are the only reasons why it loses 0.5 points to get it to the perfect score. But then again, what album is perfect? So it's as perfect as it can really get. So that is it for me. Seriously, if you have not listened to this, go listen to it in its entirety. Turn the lights off, just isolate yourself, and just go into this. Feel this album. It is a journey. It's a masterpiece. It is phenomenal. I don't see why you would be disappointed unless you are a cretin with a simple mind. So that'll be it from me. Phenomenal album. I've loved my entire time with this thing. So I hope you guys enjoy. And I'll see you next time, guys.